his young baby, you would see the child sleeping with the mouth open a lot, or the child's having disturbed sleep. There may be a child that's crawling around the bed a lot during the night, or maybe having nightmares or night terrors or waking up a lot. Maybe they're wetting the bed quite regularly. For little toddlers, they may have some allergies that's not picked up. And if you look at some of the children when they're sitting down looking at TV or in the car seat, you might see them with their mouth open and they're drooling. Why is the mouth open? Well, the mouth's open because they've never really learned how to breathe through the nose properly. And of course, all little babies, when they're born, they're all natural nose breathers. But they lose that at an early age if they've been picking up infections, or they're sleeping in possibly too warm a house, and then they've eventually just created a habit to the mouth breathing, and that will change the way that structure of the face is growing. The face will look flatter. They may have shadows under the eyes. They may be sniffly a lot. They're rubbing their noses a lot, and you'll notice that the lower jaw, the lower lip, is beginning to slip down, or maybe even the front teeth are beginning to stick out a little bit. This little muscle here, if the child is unable to keep the lips together, you'll see them the odd time that they're trying to push the lower lip up to get a lip seal. You may notice as well that child's not eating easily. They're having to gulp food down. The other impediments there would be things that should have been picked up at birth, which is a tongue tie or a lip tie. And these are things that would have influenced powerfully how a mother would have been able to breastfeed or not. Not all children can't breastfeed if they're tongue tied. Some can. That's just because they're maybe not as tied as badly, and some kids will manage to breastfeed. But it's the tie itself will prevent that tongue resting in the roof of the mouth again. So the facial structure will still not grow to its full potential. Doctors may have many children presenting with recurrent ear infections, recurrent tonsillitis, chesty coughs, irritable children that tend to be turning up to doctor surgeries quite a lot. Most of the doctors will tend to refer if they're getting recurrent tonsillitis, for instance, and you know, these sore throats, if they're not responding to antibiotics, and they'll be referred off to ENT evaluation earlier on. Then they may have the tonsils removed, or they maybe just put the grommets in and hopefully they'll grow out of things like that. Dentists should be aware when they see children turning up and they've got mild crowding of their lower teeth, for instance, at 7 years of age. Their teeth are being worn down from grinding. They've got the lower lip falling back and the front teeth are beginning to come forward. They should be aware of stuff like that. That's really just an indication that the structure isn't growing as it should be. And it's time to do something about it. And I think doctors probably aren't quite aware of the connection really between the powerful effect that the tongue has in growing the face forward. And if they try to remember their anatomy a little bit earlier on, the airway is really affected by this poor facial growth in the early years. And the child who's going to have a retruded jaw, smaller air space, and this is what's creating those problems mostly. If patients are having disturbed sleep or snoring, is an indicator that airflow may not be efficient to the lungs, and hence the oxygen supply again to the brain. If the oxygen supply isn't efficient, then of course brain cells are going to be affected here. And this has been shown in the MRI scans now, that their areas in the brain are actually obliterated, and especially memory cells. We know that the human being, once we started to stand upright, the female, the head of the child is about 13 centimeters, and the cervix is only going to stretch to 10 centimeters. The human head, in order for the baby to be born, has to actually contract here. So once it starts to contract, it can fit down the birth canal, and later on it's going to expand again. So the bones of the skull have to slide over each other for the baby to be born. Now, children that are having difficulty being born often are guided down with the help of a forceps or a suction birth. So therefore, they're putting other forces there that are unnatural on the skulls of those children, which can affect the way the cranium will go and develop later on, and they can be left with trauma to their heads, which may not be picked up or they may not get treatment for until they're later into their teens even. But these kind of things will influence how the structure of the face will may grow and develop as well, because all the bones are connected here. The top jaw is connected to 22 other bones in the skull. So it needs to be addressed earlier on. More babies could be helped if there was possible treatment with an osteopath at a very young age. Children that have not experienced the birth canal, like C-section babies as well, have not had the same expansion, contraction of the cranium, and that can also have effects on how that child grows and develops as well. When we were hunter-gatherer people on the plains of Africa, which isn't terribly long ago, we had much more pronatic faces. In fact, even if you go to the third world today, you will still see evidence there of children who have been breastfed and they've eaten pretty normal diets. They have good structure. But now we're looking at a different scenario in the Western world where we've had a big change. And the human face has, as I said, been shrinking for 10,000 years, and that started happening with a change from being hunter-gatherers to agricultural people, growing crops, eating a different diet. And then we had the most rapid change since the Industrial Revolution. And that's only about 200 years ago when we had a huge change. Mothers had to give up breastfeeding because they were going to work. So the child wasn't being breastfed anymore. And then we had an introduction in softer foods. So there was a change in diet again. And then if we look at the anthropology evidence again, we had a big change then when we saw the structure deteriorating more. And this has been well documented as well in a book by Weston Price. And if anybody wants to read a little bit more about that, it's there for anyone to read. And he was a dentist who traveled the world in the 1930s with his wife, went to the most remote parts of the world, looked at the primitive people, what they were eating. He identified them for cavities. He looked at their structure. They all had lovely facial form. He noted they were much healthier. They didn't have TB and they didn't have arthritis. He went back to the same places again a generation later, and then he found that once the missionaries or Western diets had been introduced, within one generation, you saw the facial change. They had more crowded teeth, cavities were present, TB and arthritis had crept in within one generation. It's important that a child is assessed early enough, because if they're not assessed early enough, then they're going to end up with bigger problems later on. And it's easier to prevent problems developing than trying to deal with them when they become a bigger problem later on, because as adults, the structure has fully developed at that point. And, you know, in some adults, it can't be fixed unless it's by surgery. But if children are looked early enough, then the problems can be prevented. The best way to go. All we're doing now is we're treating symptoms. We're throwing lots of money at treating symptoms that all could have been prevented at a much earlier age. They have already a fantastic health service for the school system, but really it would need to be developed in a major way here. First of all, the personnel would need to be trained in how to treat these children early enough. It may save the health service a huge amount of money in general later on, because if you can improve the structure of the face as it's growing, you're going to give those children better airway. They may not grow up to be children that will develop cognitive dysfunctional problems. They may not develop their ADHD. They will most likely be healthier, so they're not going to be running to the doctor with their high blood pressure and not end up with their diabetic problems. So I think in general, if you can improve the quality of those children's lives as they're growing, getting them breathing better and getting them sleeping better, you're going to have much healthier populations. So it's got to change the way our health service is being run and stop the hospitals being overrun.